you for listening to the Performance Anxiety Podcast, a proud member of the Pantheon Podcast Network. I am your host, Mark, and this episode has been a long time in the making. I initially reached out to guitarist Jeff Young well over a year ago, but the timing was never right. Well, once the timing was right, we made up for lost time. Jeff and I had an epic discussion about his first exposure to listening and playing music. He took viola lessons in the first grade. He recounts the BB gun trade that literally changed his life. He moved from Dayton, Ohio to Hollywood to seriously pursue music. And after many false starts, he was about ready to give up and move back to Ohio when he had his first encounter with Megadeth. But it wasn't his gig yet. Jeff is honest about his time in Megadeth and why he left the band. His want ad on Headbangers Ball right after he left. Signing with Diamond Dave Management, but passing on being Steve Vai's replacement for David Lee Roth's band, which led to Jason Becker getting the gig, for which Jeff is extremely happy. But after a while, Jeff did leave music and went to the Wharton School for Business to help save the family business. But a wild series of events got him back into music, playing Farm Aid, and hanging with Willie Nelson on his tour bus, and eventually moving to Brazil to play with members of the legendary Assad family. Now, Jeff has a lot of irons in the fire, including the band with his better half called Tenifer Jinn, his YouTube channel Music Lives Live, the streaming show he's done for over 11 years, Music Without Boundaries, and a mega new project that is in the works. Follow Jeff at Jeff Scott Young on Twitter, at Jeff Young Guitar on Instagram. Follow us at Performance Annex on both, and you can support us with reviews or with money on ko-fi.com/performanceanxiety or performanceannex.threadless.com. Now buckle up for an epic mega episode with Jeff Young on Performance Anxiety on Pantheon Podcasts.
Hello there, ladies and gentlemen. Hello there, ladies and gents. Jeff Young here, guitarist, sometime DJ, and be sure to subscribe to my brand new YouTube show, Music Lives Live, web show on YouTube. But right now you're listening to Performance Anxiety. I kind of like this show. Is that ID cool?
Well, man, well, thank you so much for doing the podcast. I'm really excited about it. A little nervous, but excited.
Well, it's my pleasure. Are we taping yet, or are you going to edit this? How's it go?
Oh, I'm taping and I'll edit it.
Beautiful. I'm ready to go when you are. I'm going to take a sip of water.
Yeah.
Indeed.
So thank you so much for joining me. Like I told you before, this is just really exciting. You're one of the ones I'm a little nervous about. I don't know. I've always just loved what I've heard from of your music, and your history is just wild, and just kind of want to know a little bit more about how you got into music in the first place and what you're up to currently. So how did you get into music in the first place? What music really influenced you when you were little? What made you really get into music? Was it something that your parents were playing? Was it something that you discovered on your own?
Well, I do remember the first LP that my folks bought me was the Beatles. I think it's called the 65 album. It might be an amalgamation of hits from their other records, but I remember that pretty early on. So I was exposed to a little rock pop, but honestly, the impetus of it all, if you will, was when they came around in first grade with the stringed instruments for the orchestra.
Oh, wow. First grade.
Yeah, I chose viola. So I started playing viola in first grade. But it wasn't long into our orchestra rehearsals that I was looking across the room and lusting after that big cello and the sound that was coming out of that thing.
You had cello envy.
Exactly. It was probably some little girl playing it. So I went home, begged my mother on bended knees to let me switch from viola to cello. And I think keenly she intuited that if that were to happen, she would end up being the designated cartage service for said cello. Running me to and fro, taking me here and there. And I don't think she was game for that. So she denied that that request. And I got a little bit frustrated as a result, and I gave up the viola.
Oh, wow.
Much to my chagrin, I wish I would have stuck with it longer because, you know, and we can come back full circle. I mean, I did use it on a recent track on my new instrumental album that's being released one track at a time. I brought an amazing cellist in, and I got to kind of live vicariously through her, through this song. I got to, you know, bring the guitar and the cello together, but we can talk about that in a bit. So yeah, my first instrument was viola. And then in third grade, they came around with more of the band instruments, horns and, you know, tubas and trombones and flutes and piccolos. And something spoke to me about the tenor saxophone.
Oh, wow.
So that I did start playing from third grade, and I played that third through eighth grade. And in fact, in ninth grade, we lost our baritone sax player. The girl who sat right next to me.
Okay.
Parents moved. So the band, the band director coaxed me into switching from tenor to baritone, which meant I had to learn, you know, tenor, everything's written in treble clef.
Okay.
Baritone is written in bass clef, so I had to read a whole new style of music. But that was cool, and I think it kind of put me in the frying pan.
Right.
Right, so to speak. And honestly, just because I have a few beginning guitar students, and it's interesting that I'm really appreciating having that opportunity, because some of their complaints is like when they play with other people or even try to play with a metronome, they have a real bear of a time. And I think, you know, when you start playing at a young age and you have a band conductor and you're playing in a either an orchestra or a band setting of, you know, 25, 30 more people, it does teach you, you know, all the basic, the rudiments, the basics of rhythm, how to play in time, how to read music. That always helps.
Yeah.
You would believe a lot of great music is only written in manuscript. It's not tabbed out as we use in modern times.
You wouldn't believe the number of people I've had on the podcast who said they stopped. They didn't get into a school, a music school or something, because for their entire careers, they were faking reading music. They're playing it by ear. And then when it came time to audition for schools, they were like, oh, I guess I'm done. I can't read this. So reading music is important. When did guitar really take hold of you? When did you want to start? When did the desire to play hit you? And how long after that were you actually playing guitar?
Well, you got to remember, I grew up during the 70s and the little show called The Partridge Family.
Oh, yes.
David Cassidy, much maligned and underrated. I mean, as a singer, I mean, he had quite the rock and roll career aside from that.
Oh, for sure.
That primetime family-oriented show. But, I mean, that gave us a context as kids of what it was like playing in more of a rock pop band as opposed to, you know, what I was seeing, you know, when I went to school.
Yeah. Right?
And even I took music theory courses, and all of that is geared more towards orchestral instruments. And although I did arrange, I remember Yesterday by the Beatles for like strings, like cello, viola, and I forget what bass and violin. That was one of our assignments that we had to do. But so that the television set gave us that context. I missed Ed Sullivan. I saw some of that stuff, but I don't remember the Beatles or
right
any of that stuff. But I definitely remember the Partridge Family and some other shows, H.R. Puffin stuff, had a little bit of a musical.
Yeah, I remember
had
that.
A musical bend to it. Those guys, whoever wrote that, were definitely...
Sid and Marty Croft.
Yeah, they were... partaking in some herbal essence. I would fathom.
Well, man, just that name has to be.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, but it's actually a funny story. It's around age 14, which must have been, I'm not sure if I was still playing tenor sax or baritone by this time, and he coaxed me back for another year. I forget the series of events, but my buddy who lived down the street, his name's Matt Cecil. Shout out to my buddy. He happens to tune in. We were childhood friends from sixth grade. So it wasn't too many years later that he decided he was going to play guitar. And in tandem, I looked through the local paper and bought myself a BB gun. Remember the Daisy?
Oh, yeah.
Brand? Daisy Brandby. I mean, think of how safe. They can't even play darts anymore. I remember jarts.
Yeah. Just throw a big dart up in the air until one kid's left.
Yeah, we all lived.
Yeah.
To tell about it.
You try to get in that little hula hoop thing.
That's yeah.
Great. We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors. This podcast is sponsored by BetterHelp. Without a healthy mind, being truly happy and at peace is hard. The good news is, therapy works. But what is therapy exactly? It's whatever you want it to be. Maybe you're not feeling motivated right now and would like some tools to help. Or maybe you're feeling insecure in relationships or at work, not dealing well with the stress. Whatever you need, it's time to stop being ashamed of normal human struggles and start feeling better because you deserve to be happy. And now you don't have to worry about finding an in-person therapist near you to help. BetterHelp is customized online therapy that offers video, phone, and even live chat sessions with your therapist, so you don't have to see anyone on camera if you don't want to. It's much more affordable than in-person therapy, and you can start communicating with your therapist in under 48 hours. Try doing that in person. So join the millions of people who are seeing what online therapy is really about. It's always a good time to invest in yourself because you are your greatest asset. And a special offer to Performance Anxiety listeners, you can get 10% off your first month of professional therapy at betterhelp.com/performanceanxiety. That's betterhelp.com/performanceanxiety. Thanks again to BetterHelp for sponsoring this podcast.
So my buddy's playing guitar. I have this gun and, you know, I'm shooting bottles and targets and, you know, I couldn't shoot an animal, to be honest. And that's what all my buddies were doing. And it wasn't a month or two after he got that guitar that I went down to his house one day and looked around his room and I'm like, hey, buddy, where's your guitar? And he opened his closet and it's like way in the back of his closet.
Oh, I'm like,
yeah, a little bit shocked. And what's up with that, my friend? He's, that thing's too damn hard to play. And a light bulb went off in my head. And I mean, this was a cheap guitar. It was one of those probably $30, $40 numbers from Sears or Kmart that, yeah, the pickguard looked like a old Fender medium guitar pick.
Yeah. Right?
There's a ton of guitars in the 70s with that pickguard.
Yes.
Every $30, $40 guitar had that pickguard.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
So I said, well, how about this? I'll trade you my Daisy BB gun for your $30, $40 guitar with the gaudy pickguard. And he was like sold, you know, and it was a done deal. So That was 14 years old. And I remember the first thing I did is I had this, it was a reel to reel tape machine. I don't remember the brand and like the cover had been lost, but it worked.
Yeah.
And somehow I figured if I plugged this guitar into there, you know, I had a amplification. Albeit there was no, what we call today in the business, overdrive or gain or distortion, but I was making sound and, you know, you're 14 and you're on your way. So
yeah.
I remember the first things I was figuring out was, of course, all the old standbys, Smoke on the Water, only on the low string. And I hadn't figured out that it was plucked with, you know, fingers on the D and G string yet. I hadn't sussed that out. I remember Stairway to Heaven, the intro, trying to get that. And I had the gist of it, but there's that one jazz chord, this like the fourth chord where you shift position, that I wasn't getting at 14. And I hadn't had any guitar lessons yet. This was just doing by ear.
Oh, wow.
Doing by ear off records. And then More Than a Feeling by Boston. So that maybe gives you the, I mean, that was right out on the radio. So that maybe puts you in a time capsule back to where it all began.
Right. It sure does.
And the funny thing is, from those three songs, I was on it. I was locked and loaded and all about it, obsessed, and spending every spare moment on the guitar and the saxophone, sadly, lying lonely in the case, too many afternoons after school. And
should have tried to trade somebody another BB gun for it.
Yeah, with the sax. I wish I still had that sax. But check it out. The funny part, I mean, this has got to be in my book, and I often tell this story because it's just so epic. So I don't know about your school, but our school and many schools in the, I was class of 80 when I got out of high school, but talent shows. Do you remember talent shows? I mean, for that High School Musical, the movie that my kids love so much.
Yeah.
As kids, I think they outgrew, but very much like that in our school.
Okay.
In Centerville, Ohio, Dayton, Ohio, little suburb. And so our band always played in the pit. The school band was down in the pit, and we would play during switchovers from, I mean, there could be comedy acts, juggling. I mean, what are kids that age going to do? I mean, there's a little bit of everything and not a whole lot of quality.
Right.
If I had to relive it. But I remember a few cool things I did. I did do one year something with about Charlie Chaplin, where me and my buddy wrote a skit, and I was Charlie Chaplin, and in a park I stole his newspaper, and that came off really good in the talent show. But let's fast forward that, but I digress to fast forward. This year I was going to play guitar for my first time on stage in public. And I'd be going back and forth. That meant I'd be playing in the pit on the saxophone and then ducking out at a certain point, like a song before, and then going up and doing my little bit and getting off. And I remember what I was going to do was Peter Frampton, because Frampton Comes Alive had just come out, and that was all the rage. Baby, I Love Your Way. I mean, and that would have been cool. And I had it down, and I had the guitar down, and I had the vocal down. Unfortunately, my voice decided it was going to change.
Right.
Oh. My voice started changing, so I couldn't. There was no way that I was going to sing it. And I had sung all through school and been in plays, Oliver Twist and whatnot.
Oh, wow.
I opted to just play, so I made a medley. And I don't know how I came up with this, probably because it's the hottest songs that I had just learned. It was some kind of a awkward medley of Toys in the Attic and Freebird.
Oh. Oh my gosh. That's
instrumental. Just like instrumental, I'm just playing highlight riffs, rhythms from both songs, and somehow I morphed them together, and that was my first time on stage.
That is awesome. Oh, I wish I could hear that.
Yeah, I got a picture of it. I don't have any audio. Cell phones were a little bit shy back then. And
yeah.
Not even a lot of people had the home movie cameras and whatnot.
Right.
But that was the beginning. So the funny part about the whole thing is my band conductor, and his name was Mr. Freeman. But my mind, the first name that always comes to my mind is Mr. Finkham, because This cat was a rat, Frank.
Oh.
Right in front of the whole class. In front of the whole class one day, you know, we had band class was a period out of your seven periods in a day. You know, if you played an instrument, that was one of your periods that you would have.
Right.
Where you'd attend that. And I remember one day in pre-production for the talent show, the teacher, one of the teacher, whoever was the director of the whole shebang, came in. She politely stuck her head into the band class and said, Jeff Young, we need you on the stage. To that, as I stood up, I put my sax down, I started collecting my things, and Mr. Finkham, in front of the whole class, he shamed me. He said, Jeff Young, what are you doing? And I said, well, I have to go rehearse really quick my song. I'll be right back. And you know, I was fully intending to come right back and rejoin our regularly scheduled school programming.
Right.
Already in progress, but I was just going to run out and do that. It would have taken 5-10 minutes. Jeff Young, you care more about that guitar than you do about your saxophone anymore. You should just give up that saxophone and go make love to that thing.
Whoa.
I mean, think of the era. Like, I mean, maybe you'd see that in a movie today, or maybe the way people talk to each other. But back then, that was like, I'd never heard anything like that or seen in a movie or heard a fellow student tell me anything like that. So I promptly told him to fuck off in front of the whole class, which then the first response to what he said was everyone was aghast.
Right.
And then when I said that, everyone busted out laughing and you know, kind of lightened the mood, to be honest. He was like, all right, I deserve that. And I owe you an apology. I probably shouldn't have said that. Cause then he probably realized, like, I'm going to tell my parents. And
yeah.
I don't know if I ever did tell my parents, and I don't think that he ever got in trouble as he well should have for that.
Yeah.
Indeed. Oh, but God. I did take his advice and I gave up the sax and, wow, I've been making love to the guitar ever since.
All right, so you started out at 14. When did you start playing in bands?
Like pretty soon thereafter.
Okay.
My friend wasn't long after. As a matter of fact, the kid who played trumpet in our school band also played drums and guitar, and he'd already figured out a bunch of Van Halen stuff.
Oh, wow.
And I was going by that time, and I'd probably done some other silly bands before that where no one could really play. But I remember this band we dubbed Iron Cross.
Oh,
it's funny. There's a band now called Iron Cross. I'm like, why are you? And the other buddy was his neighbor who played bass, and he was really into Michael Anthony, Frank Churko, and Tom Thigerson was the trumpet player. And so we showed each other. I was figuring out Zeppelin and Aerosmith stuff and Yes. And
oh, nice.
I was just getting into Van Halen. You know, you remember, like, they kind of came in. There was a lot of the bands before Jethro Tull. I was into their stuff and some of the proggy stuff, just anything that was cool. And then disco hit, and then Van Halen, and I was just getting on board with that, and they were already kind of ahead of me. But he knew I was a better guitar player, so he showed me what he knew of the Van Halen, and he got behind the drums, and we had a trio with no singer.
Oh, wow.
Doing a ton of Van Halen, you know, Aerosmith off the first album, Lord of the Thighs, stuff like that.
Oh yeah.
So that was my first band, and we played school dances and keg parties. I remember that, you know, before the football games on Friday nights, they'd have out at this lodge, Bear Creek Lodge, they'd have keg parties, and we always seemed to end up playing there. And my buddy, who didn't play an instrument, he was the neighbor to Matt Cecil, who traded me that first guitar, Bob Ellis.
Oh, wow.
He figured out how to do the concussion mortars, because we were all starting to get into Kiss too, right?
Oh, yeah.
And so we had the explosions at the keg parties with saltpeter. What was it? Saltpeter and something else.
Oh, my gosh.
And And he had the 2x4s and 10 cans nailed to him, and he had all the powder in there, and we had it all rigged with stuff that we used to make our Estes rockets launch. So we were ahead of our time.
Wow.
I got to tell you. But it was actually, some, you know, wild memories, because it was kind of cool because I was in with the jocks and the freaks because I was a musician, but the jocks were the ones putting on the keg parties for the football games.
Yeah.
And they needed us to play. So that was nice. Always cool. That was a cool thing in school. And I know that's why a lot of kids get into comedy. I've heard comedians say the same thing. Like, you know, that's why I got into comedy.
Yeah.
Because I wouldn't get picked on in school or beat up. And
yeah,
maybe it's the same for some of us musicians.
That's a very interesting parallel. I didn't think about it like that. At what point did you think that this is something you wanted to pursue professionally? Because you did study at GIT. So when did it hit you that, oh, this is what I want to do?
Oh, remember when I told you about watching The Partridge Family?
Yeah.
So, I mean, of course, then. I mean, I had the David Cassidy haircut.
Oh, nice.
I found the most David Cassidy shirts that I could find. So, yeah, but, you know, at that age, you're playing around and it's not serious, and you kind of come back and forth between sports and music and
yeah.
girls and whatever, distractions.
Yeah, exactly.
With BB guns or Estes rockets, dirt bikes, go-karts, all that stuff.
Yeah.
But I think once I bought Kiss, I remember, and once I figured out there was no Santa Claus, my mom started letting me just like pick out my presents. We'd go shopping, but then she'd just hide them away and wrap them, and then I'd open them. You know, you wouldn't always remember what you got and
right.
what shape things were. And I remember coming to the cart with Kiss Alive 1 in hand, and she took one look at that and her face went white.
Oh.
You know, as white as their kabuki makeup.
Right.
I she's like, okay, here we go.
Oh boy.
Here we go. But she bought it for me. And I think it was on from there, and Aerosmith and Zeppelin. I mean, it was that whole early hierarchy of, you know, iconic bands. Yes.
Yeah.
Jethro Tull, Led Zeppelin, all of them. And then the lesser bands, because I had buddies and bandmates that worked at record stores. So we knew all the cool music right when it came out.
Oh, nice. Know?
So it just went from there. And then you're playing cover bands, different cover band dates all over your town and mm-hmm. state and tri-state area. And before I moved to, you mentioned, I went out to GIT, Musicians Institute. We made it so far as the Knoxville World's Fair.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, you'd have to Google what year that was. Knoxville, Tennessee. We opened for, our band was Black Widow. We were actually kind of heavy. By this time, we were covering like Iron Maiden, Murders in the Rue Morgue.
Oh, nice.
Spasmatics off Coup d'Etat, Children of the Damned, just Saxon, Dallas 1 PM, just like Riot, Swords and Tequila, plus all, you know, Neon Knights.
Oh, nice.
All the heavy stuff that was popular with a female singer. I mean,
oh, you know, that's
we started
cool.
out doing Benatar, Pretenders and bands like that.
Yeah.
And ended up giving our singer nodes on her vocal cords from screaming too much.
Oh,
maybe
my God.
It was that screen in Number of the Beast that she had to do every night.
Oh, but, wow.
Yeah, so we evolved as music evolved, and we discovered different genres, and the different players that you hang around expose you to different music.
Yeah.
I mean, the first Def Leppard, On Through the Night, and High and Dry were huge for us. Riot. We kind of were in that vibe.
Okay.
Like some Sabbath for a young band, but with a female singer. I'm going to put all this stuff out. I still have that demo. It was a 4-song demo.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That
I have
is
a
awesome.
Few. I'd love to. I'm actually talking to a couple companies right now. We'll see what happens and how it finally sees the light of day. But
that would be cool.
Yeah. So she got nodes on her vocal cords, and then we found a singer from Cincinnati that, this guy was amazing. He looked like Bon Scott, and he was like even missing teeth, right? His name was Richard Lewis. He's been playing with Randy Piper from Wasp for years.
Really?
Piper even moved to Cincinnati, Ohio because of this singer.
Oh my
God. He was my last singer in Ohio before I moved out to California. They had a band called Animal.
Okay.
And my guitar player from Black Widow, who's passed away, was in that original incarnation with Randy Piper and Animal, I think.
Oh,
I believe. I kind of lost touch with the guys, but this guy was incredible. He could definitely do Blackie Lawless because he was like a mimic, like a Rich Little of vocals. We went down to see him one night in Cincinnati playing with his cover band Prisoner, and he on point singing Dio, both AC/DC singers.
Oh my gosh.
Iron Maiden. And he sounded like, you know, when he would do the singer, he would change character, and Cat was great.
Wow.
So right after that, you know, after a set, we walked up and snaked him. We had a booking agent, and but he had a drinking problem, and some other members of our band had substance abuse problems. And at that point I said, am I going to stay here in Dayton and just play cover tunes the rest of my life, or refer to the final page of a recent Guitar Player magazine that had a profile of a little known school that was at the time above the Hollywood Wax Museum on Highland Boulevard, a stone's throw from Hollywood and Highland. It was actually on Hollywood and Highland. And I read this one page article and I saw that Tommy Tedesco from the Wrecking Crew and Don Mock and Scott Henderson, who's just a sick player. And I was already, you know, by this time starting to get into Alan Holdsworth, UK, and stuff along those lines. So I was flipping out. Just, it took one page to sell me on that school. So whoever wrote that article, I'm sure I'm not the only one.
Right. Yeah.
Read that. And I remember after rehearsal one day, I went up and everyone was downstairs, probably smoking out after rehearsal and drinking beer. And I used to have a mirror in my drawer, in my, you know, socks and t-shirts top drawer, that I would watch my hands play while I rehearsed. I was sitting there. I went straight up from rehearsal downstairs and started practice. And I just, something just struck me. I said, am I going to stay here in Dayton, you know, doing this, or am I going to go out to that school? And I begged my parents, begged. And the rest is history. Wow. Somehow I convinced them, because I mean, I didn't know anyone out here. I'm in Los Angeles now. At the time, I didn't know anyone. And, you know, I was in my early 20s by this time. And that's pretty scary.
Yeah.
I luckily, there was a kid that was a couple grades ahead of me that had just gone out to GIT and came back and was teaching guitar lessons at the local music store.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so I decided, well, how about I'll sign up for some private lessons with him and get the curriculum ahead of time. I'll be way ahead of the game. Turns out the guy he lived with in Van Nuys, which, you know, not far from where I live now, and this guy's my buddy to this day. I'm looking at my private message. He just messaged me an hour ago.
Yeah.
I mean, which is a great thing to be able to say, you know, from 1984 till now, I moved in with this total stranger who, you know, because my buddy had moved back to Ohio, was teaching guitar lessons. This guy out in California needed a roommate, and he actually gave me the bedroom and took the living room as his bedroom.
Oh, wow. Because
it was a small place. I mean, I think our total rent at that time was like $475.
Oh, geez.
Harkening back to yesteryear and more innocent times.
For sure. Oh my gosh.
Watercolor memories. But so it's amazing. I just happen to have my private messages up on Facebook, and I see that he just messaged me an hour ago.
Oh, nice.
Larry, as long as we're name dropping tonight.
Yeah.
He lives in Portland now, and he lived in Austin. He played guitar. He was a graduate of GIT, and we lived together and we've been buddies. So he's seen every demo, everything I've done since GIT till
Oh wow.
Till this evening,
And he even
heard stuff that's not out yet.
Oh, my gosh.
Slated for summer release.
Oh, that is awesome.
Got stuff coming out. We got a song coming out next month.
We'll be right back after a word from our sponsors. Hey, guys, I want to talk to you about socks for a second. Why not? It's a music podcast. But I tried a pair of socks from Boldfoot and love them. I've only worn them once because my kids have stolen them. So in my household, that's the best endorsement I can give. And I guess it's fitting because the design I chose was jailbait. Wait, jailbird. The design I chose was jailbird. I might keep that in. The socks are 100% American made and 5% of all proceeds go to veteran charities. It makes sense, seeing that Boldfoot is a family and veteran-owned company. They have a huge variety of styles. So check out boldfoot.com and buy some of the best socks you've ever slapped on your feet. And help veterans while you're at it. That's boldfoot.com.
So that takes us from 14 to 1984, when I'm out here in Hollywood going to GIT.
And so I'm assuming while you're at GIT, you're playing in bands while you're out there, or are you concentrating on just studying?
No, actually, right before, you know, by the time I moved out there, I had dissected every Eddie Van Halen lick at half speed at, you know, 16. We figured out some of us as kids before YouTube and guitar trainers and cassette players that have all these different settings on them, which I did use by the time I went to GIT. But before that, I don't even know how I figured it out. I just did it to slow it down, and I didn't know the bonus was that when you slowed a turntable down from 33 to 16, it sounds like quicksand, but it's a perfect octave lower if your turntable works well.
Right.
So it's the same notes, half speed. It sounds a little garbly, you know,
yeah,
an octave lower, and that technology that we had to use at the time. But I mean, that's how I figured out Eruption, Spanish Fly. I spent 4 months figuring out Spanish Fly and all the Randy Rhoads stuff, all the Aerosmith. Yes. Everything that I've mentioned or, you know, that ever became a part of my early influence. That's how we did it. You know, we'd slow down the record, all of my cover band stuff, to try to get the solos spot on.
Okay.
And I'd been through Eddie, Randy, and getting into Holsworth, and then Yngwie came out.
Oh, yeah.
On the Alcatraz, No Parole from Rock and Roll, and that knocked my socks off. Not because I was already really into classical playing. I got a classical teacher at 16 as soon as I heard D, Diary of a Madman, and the stuff, you know, The Trees, Farewell to Kings.
Yeah. Oh, you know, classics.
The songs that all of our rock guys were bringing nylon string and classical or flamenco elements into rock music and fusing it. So I was on that, and we had a great classical teacher in our town. He's still, to this day, he goes around and teaches kids. He's known as the guitar man in Dayton, Ohio. He head of the guitar department at the University of Dayton.
Wow.
So teaching college all the way down to young kids, and he just loves guitars. So, that's, you know, awesome. It's kind of an honor that I studied with. He's an artisan, you know, I think, of guitar music, and I really respect that. But when Yngwie came out, of course, that was next level, you know, playing classical motifs in Paganini and Bach licks at blinding speed. And it was also his tone on that album. I think even to this day was his best tone on that first Alcatraz album.
Man, I haven't heard that in a while.
So I was back at the turntable, skipping school.
Yeah.
Back at the, you know, 8 hours, 14 hours a day. I made a mission. I think that album came out maybe four, six months before I moved to California, that I was gonna figure out as much of that record note for note as I could.
As
an ear training exercise, but also to help getting my picking and chops together. And I was just, I mean, that was at the forefront of the neoclassical shred movement.
Yeah.
You know, and the Shrapnel Records and Mike Varney was just busting out, and Paul Gilbert was actually he arrived at GIT during my second half of my year. At the time, it's now, you can do a 4-year course there, but at the time it was like a 1-year vocational school.
Oh, okay. Like,
you know, when you'd go to a technical school to learn how to be an electrician or something, it was a year.
Yeah.
It was like that, but every class was guitar in your hand, every class. You're not learning history, social studies, algebra.
Right, right.
You know, it's all guitar and like a crash course. I have the books right behind me from 84. I still can refer back to it. It's like, you know, 5 inches thick of material that serves you for a lifetime.
Oh, that is awesome. So at this time, were you writing your own music or were you just focusing more on playing covers or classical?
Yeah, from the time I was in Black Widow, and then when we got that singer from Cincinnati, we changed our band to Ravencraft, which I always thought was a great band name.
Yeah.
Don't steal it, anybody. I've always been doing originals, and I have a lot of demos throughout the years.
Okay.
So, yeah, both. But the hardest thing to do was find, you know, when you're looking at bands and you're benchmarking, if you're figuring this stuff out off records and these are your heroes and the people you're looking up to, Zeppelin and Aerosmith, you're looking for musicians that are like that, bass players that are as good as John Paul Jones or Tom Hamilton or Chris Squire, and singers that are as good as Steven Tyler or Robert Plant and Roger Daltrey, and those are few and far between.
Oh, for sure.
Again, even at GIT, we didn't have a singer. Our band was a bass player from BIT, Bass Institute, a percussionist, a drummer from the PIT, Percussion Institute of Technology. At the time, there was only 3 areas. Now they have guitar making, business, recording, keyboards, vocals. They have everything. But at the time, it was just GIT, BIT, and PIT. And so we had, there we were again, a trio, power trio, but no singer. You know, there was no VIT at the time, and we actually ended up morphing, and that drummer fell away, and we auditioned a kid who played like Neil Peartman. He had the huge set, and his dad, actually, this was crazy. Me and this, and we're both so green, this bass player buddy of mine from Musicians Institute, we're going to audition this drummer. I don't even know how we heard out of one of the local papers or something. And he goes, okay, well, we can rehearse in my dad's studio. And me and my buddy, Alan, the bass player, thought, okay, dad's probably got a cool studio in the backyard. We're killer. This is going to be awesome.
Right.
So he gives us the address in Burbank, and we pull up, and it's Evergreen Studios that his father owns. His father was Artie Butler, if people want to Google it. The studio, I actually got to be honest, I kind of skipped a lot of my second half of my year at GIT, because once we hired this kid and when we saw the studio, we looked at each other, if the kid can play a lick, he's got the gig. And he was a killer. His name's Corey Butler, right? And his dad, Artie Butler, is legendary. This studio was where they did all the soundtracks for Dynasty. In Dallas, all the Loimar shows, Barbara Streisand's in this studio. We get to rehearse on where when we went to audition, it was like off time, on downtime. So because this kid's father owns this studio, and it had 2 studios, so whenever there was downtime, we could either rehearse or record. So that's I started really getting my like producer chops and learning how to know your way around in a recording studio.
Oh, wow. That's amazing.
Dealing with red light fever and all that stuff. And it just became natural because we're any hours, all hours of the weekend at night. And Michael Jackson was in there. I remember seeing Toto's road cases, like Jeff and Steve Picaro, Steve Lukather's road cases out in the hallway. I'm like, what is going on here? I'm on my way.
Wow.
So for the first thing so we were more focused on like writing and recording originals. And my buddy was like, the drummer said, because I was into Rush and Maiden, and I guess a lot of the bands, the guys who were in Queensryche had similar taste in music, right?
Okay, yeah.
So my buddy, I mean, in Queensryche came out right around the time when we were doing this stuff. And my buddy's like, man, you were writing like Queensryche before Queensryche. So it sounded kind of, we had a song that was kind of in the vibe of Take Hold of the Flame. And
oh, cool. Had,
yeah, it was kind of like that stuff. But again, no singer. And we were auditioning all kinds of singers. And what's amazing, because I just saw it in my news feed the other day, and you don't often see this video anymore rolling down your news feed, is one of the singers we auditioned, and we auditioned guys and girls, and we just didn't find anybody that had that, you know, they got to have the voice, mm-hmm. the personality, you got to get along with them, and they got to be a star, right?
Exactly.
One of the people who auditioned, her name was Amy, with spelled E-M-I, Cannon was her stage name. And actually, we were really into using her. She was great, kind of like Janis Joplin-y,
ooh,
raspy voice, good look. And you can see what she looks like, because what I'm leading up to is she ended up becoming one of the background singers for Motley Crue on, what tour was it, Dr. Feelgood, when they had Wildside?
Girls, girls, girls.
Oh, that video with the two girls in the back singing Wildside.
Yeah, yeah.
Amy's one of them, and she dated Mick Mars for a long time. I think they married, as a matter of fact. Unfortunately, she's passed away.
Oh.
Also, had cancer. But it's just crazy, the people who cross your path, even for a moment. You know, we rehearsed with her several times, brought her in the studio. She was trying to write some vocals over the top of the stuff. You know, I think it was too progressive for her or whatever, and it didn't work out. But imagine, flash forward a few years, and you're watching MTV and Motley Crue videos, all the videos from that era, they had those female background singers.
Yeah, just
Dr. Feelgood.
Leather with the studs. And
Yeah. So that was her.
Wow.
And so that was one of the people we auditioned, and, you know, a bunch of people who have gone on to do stuff crossed my path, and for one reason or another, it didn't work out. Keith St. John, who played with Montrose, he's in Kingdom Come now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, so wow.
That's usually how it works in Hollywood. And it's always the, you know, the struggle is finding the singer, even if you can find the rest of the band.
Yeah, exactly.
Especially think of the vocals of some of the bands that were coming off the strip in the 80s. Maybe not. We hadn't evolved to like singers that were belting like Chris Cornell and
right
Brandon Boyd from Incubus and Layne Staley yet.
Yeah, exactly. So
it was more like Vince Neil kind of singers. And I wasn't down for that. I was looking more for like a David Coverdale, Paul Rogers.
Oh, okay.
Steven Tyler kind of singer. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So yeah. So that always eludes
you. And yeah. It's a common theme from the very first bands in our garage all the way to the biggest rock stars and guitarists of today. If you see how many singers some of us have gone through.
Yeah. At what point you ended up teaching Jay Reynolds, who had the gig with Megadeth, how to play Megadeth's songs, the Chris Poland parts. So how did you know Jay, and how did that whole thing wind up with you playing for Megadeth?
Well, this is a trip, man. they say, and let's just put this out here from the get-go, that success is when preparation and hard work and luck intersect, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we've taken the story from when Mr. Finkham told me to go make love to my guitar, and I took his advice.
Yes.
On that $30 guitar, and I've worked my way up to better and better guitars by this time.
Right.
And played in a few bands, but nothing. I hadn't played out in LA yet. Around this time, and it was really, again, only in the 80s. It was a snapshot in time. It was a time never to be repeated. You know, we'll never relive it exactly how it was, but it was so, it was really neat. And it was just an amazing thing that here in Hollywood, there was a lady named Lucy Forbes, and she had a partner. I feel like her name was Susie or Sharon. I mean, this is now just shortly after I've graduated GIT.
Okay.
They had a company, the little rock and roll entrepreneurs. Lucy kind of was like a biker type of chick, a little tough and, you know.
Okay.
That kind of girl you didn't want to mess with.
Yeah.
They had a placement service for musicians where musicians from all over town who came from all over the country and all over the world, the beginning of the Welcome to the Jungle video, right?
Right, yeah.
They would put their demo tape and picture and a bio on file. And by the time I went in there, I know Alice Cooper had found some people from them.
Wow.
Carmine Appice was looking. I know they sent me up for King Cobra.
Oh, wow.
I wasn't going to dye my hair blonde, but I did end up playing with Carmine years later. And there's some video of us in the drum war stuff.
I've seen that. Yeah.
Dio and Sabbath.
Mob Rules. Yeah. Yeah.
Placement service, and my band from GIT, the little trio, had busted up, and my buddy, the drummer, and that whole situation with the studio had blown apart for one reason or another, because we're all 20-somethings, young, dumb, and
right,
you know. I decided I was going to go down there and put my demo tape, picture, and bio on file, right? So I went down and they popped my tape in the cassette player. For you young kids out there, you might have to Google that.
Right.
Cassette tape player. They listened for literally like 20 seconds and she looked up at me, the assistant. She goes, "This is you? You wrote this stuff? You wrote this stuff?" And I said, "Yeah." She goes, "We know this stuff. We love this tape." We go, "We got your bass player, Alan, already on file."
Oh, wow.
My bass player, Alan from BIT, because our band hit a blade, he was already down there on file. And I think they ended up getting him. His first thing that I knew he did post me was playing with Michelangelo Battio, the ambidextrous guitar shredder dude.
Yeah, they got like the wig. Like the five-necked guitar or something.
Yeah, so they had my tape already on file from my bass player. And so they were ready to take me on right then and there. And that night they took me over to this guy who was a photographer, now turned rock and roll manager. His name's Barry Levine. He's actually really well known. He was involved in the movie Detroit Rock City.
Okay.
He works for Gene Simmons to this day. He did the album cover for Angel, where they're right side up and upside down with the mirror on earth as it is in heaven.
Yes.
Killer logo that you can read upside down and right side up. He did that album cover. He did, I think, the one before Hell of a Band. He did Aerosmith. He did Kiss. He did Molly Crew, Shout at the Devil album cover. Like, if you open that gatefold, those beautiful pictures of the band.
Yeah.
Probably the best pics they ever took. That inside of Shout at the Devil, right?
Yeah, yeah.
That was Barry Levine. Wow. He did the Shout at the Devil video. He did the Girls, Girls, Girls album cover. And this was while I was living in his house.
Oh,
it was during, man, when I moved into the band. We called it the Band House in West Hollywood. It was him. They took me these ladies from Rock Congress that night on a dime. That's how your life back then could be. It sounds like something out of a movie, right?
Yeah.
Like out of rock star. And funny, that movie with Mark Wahlberg, that dude grew up in Columbus, you know, an hour from where I grew up in Dayton, Ohio. Tim the Ripper Owens. We're both from Ohio.
Yeah.
We're both Buckeyes. I'm from Dayton. He's from Columbus.
Oh, cool.
But it's like that kind of rock and roll story where I just walked in to put my tape on file and hope I could get some kind of an opportunity, even with a local band or something playing around town.
Right.
And that same night, I'm over sitting in Barry's living room and he wants to manage me. He hears the tape and he shows me this photo. I mean, he not didn't just do rock stars. He shows me a photo of him that I don't think he's ever even published to this day, which for me, wow, at least in my 20 something mind, and I know the stuff was amazing because it blew me away. He opens this portfolio of pictures of all these actresses, Cher, like coming over a snow capped hill with these huskies, something that you'd see like Frank Frazetta paint,
right?
The guy who did the Molly Hatchet album covers. I'm like, my wow, mind is just blowing apart. He's showing me this stuff within like a half hour of meeting him.
Oh my gosh.
Pam Darber from Mork and Mindy, he did her like it's some museum here. She got out on this giant lily pad and she was like a fairy princess, right?
Oh, wow.
And all these other actresses, Jane Kennedy, a popular actress from the 70s, he had her in some superwoman setting. So he's just blowing my mind with all the bands that he's photogged and actresses. And this guy wants to manage me.
Man.
And so I moved into his house in pretty short order. And his partner, who actually was the owner or leaser of the house, was named Chris Key. And he had a 16-track studio that he knew how to run upstairs, analog tape. So there again, I went from that amazing studio that I told you about, Evergreen.
Mm-hmm.
I worked in while I was skipping school. Theme of my life, skipping school and elementary and junior and high school, you know, with the turntable and then skipping school, working at the recording studio. And now I'm living in this band house and trip out on this. So we were putting the band together around me. And who's living in the back of the house? There was like, and it was weird because this house had a second floor where my room was, and that's where the recording studio was. And here I am again, getting to work in a cool recording studio 24/7.
Oh, wow.
Anytime that, you know, that we're all awake and ready to work, we can just walk in and pick up where we left off. Right.
Right. Yeah.
In the back of the house, downstairs off the kitchen, was like a guest part of the house that I never even went in. I never saw it. I don't know how big it was, but I can honestly say my roommate who lived back in there with his girlfriend was Punky Meadows from Angel.
Oh, wow.
And he was so reclusive at the time, like as reclusive as he's been over the years until their recent reunion. Like, I think he only came out into the main part of the house like two or three times.
Wow.
At the time, he had blonde hair, kind of the same style, but short, above his shoulders cut.
Oh, wow.
So I was like, I can't even believe it. And so Barry, we're producing a tape, and he goes, you need to work with someone that can help you hone all these great ideas you have. And so he calls Barry Brandt, the drummer from Angel. And then we start going down rehearsing in this big, I don't know what the place is called, but oddly enough, the guy who runs it to this day now is Chris Poland from Megadeth. He inherited it from this old man who ran it probably back in the day when I used to rehearse there with Barry. We'd go down to this rehearsal studio where Barry's drums were, and I was paying the rent. I had a little, my father had passed away. I had a little inheritance money, and
okay,
I was able to finance a demo. And Barry, I'd go pick him up in the Hollywood Hills every day, and we go to this rehearsal space, and I'd play my riffs through my amp, you know, and he'd help me dissect them and turn them into songs. And I still have that tape.
Oh, wow.
I'd like to get all this stuff to come out so people can hear kind of like the evolution.
Oh, but
yeah. So I got to work with him, and that was my first recording demo tape experience in Los Angeles was that. And then, and that was just for recording. And we ended up putting a girl we found on vocals, and she sounded like Ann Wilson. She was great.
Whoa.
But she didn't have the look, and it just wasn't right. And I really wanted a guy singer,
yeah,
to be honest. So I kept looking, and we ended up putting a band together around me called Broken Silence, and that demo tape's kind of, our singer kind of stole it and put it out, and it's floating around the internet, so people can sometimes find that if they look hard enough. His voice was, that was amazing. He had a range like Steve Perry, but a little more rasp. Was amazing and snorted a ton of blow and still sang like a bird. So it was kind of like Journey meets Dokken meets Gary Moore.
Oh my gosh.
Like the Corridors of Power, Gamma stuff. I love Gamma, the Japanese import Gary Moore did that a lot of Americans haven't even heard. It's one of my favorite Gary Moore albums, but you know, I always love like the whole Gary Moore, John Sykes, John Norum.
Oh, I love John Sykes.
Thing. Yeah. So like way before Whitesnake, Tigers of Pantang.
Tigers of Pantang. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was, and like, I mean, you got Gary Moore and then you got his disciples, which are people like John Sykes, John Norum, and me.
Right.
Right. And Jack Moore, his son, who's been on my radio show, who's a fine player. Chip off the old block, as they say.
Oh, nice.
So, and Barry took that band as our manager all the way to the point where we did a showcase at the Roxy.
Okay.
It was attended by, it actually got written up in the LA Weekly, and there was a picture of me I still have in my scrapbook. It said, Broken Silence played an impressive showcase at the Roxy, you know, sold out, blah, blah, blah. That was attended by the likes of Nikki Sixx and Mick Mars, the Bangles.
Oh, wow.
And I ended up going to a party at Susanna Hoff's house as a result of that, which was pretty cool. She's really cool, right?
That's guys? Awesome. Yeah.
Time to walk like an Egyptian. Doesn't that just play through your mind the second I say
it? Yes, it does.
And Stray Cats, Slim Jim.
Slim Jim Phantom?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome.
Which is weird because years later, I played on a bill with him and Lemmy in Vegas for a cancer benefit. So it's like, again, it's a small world after all in the music business. But we did a showcase and we were close to signing with Chrysalis Records, which was... For me, as I mentioned back, well, if we, you know, the listeners are still with us, the first band we started out playing Benatar, because I love Neil Girardo still to this day, and Pat Benatar. And
yeah.
She just had a great raspy, ballsy voice, unlike any. There's never been a female singer like her before or since.
Nope.
And nor a guitar player who... played with a female like that, like how Eddie played with Roth or Sammy, or how Jimmy played with Robert.
Right.
You know, his leads were killer. And I've heard a lot of guys cite Neil Girardo as an influence. But, you know, so for a guy from Kettering, Ohio, you know, the Ohio Players said we could do this. They were from Dayton and we knew like you could be from Dayton and you could do this. We all looked up to the Ohio Players and I love funk to this day because of it. But, you know, to love Pat Benatar, Neil Girardo, and all right, we're negotiating with Chrysalis Records, who's their label, and some other really cool bands as well. But the band was just, like I said, that's... To embellish on what I mentioned about the singer, we were doing our second demo, like a record company had given us demo money based off the first demo we had.
Okay.
And we were demoing a second batch of tracks, which were even better. And unfortunately, I've lost to this day. So those songs will never see the light of day.
Oh.
I remember some titles, but I do remember one riff. I could, and if it's that good, I better make a song out of it.
Yeah. Right?
We were going down to San Diego at this studio where Berlin and some other cool bands had recorded at the time. I remember they had just done that Top Gun soundtrack and were really popular. So we were all excited. Ah, Berlin recorded here and a couple other cool bands. And we got, again, it was kind of like we got to work there on downtime, like that studio I worked at during my GIT era.
Yeah.
So we'd drive down there and work weird hours, day, weekends, afternoons, if it was unbooked, or nights late. I saw this singer one day. We were out in the lobby and we were the only ones there, and the engineer was in there doing something. He laid out a line of cocaine, and I hate this stuff, but he laid out a line of cocaine that it was like, you know, a half inch thick.
Oh my God.
3 feet long.
What?
And just snorted it.
Oh,
before he's got to sing.
God.
I'm like, this cat's insane.
Whoa.
He's blitz.
Yeah.
You know? And I didn't know, man, he was out there singing like a bird. When you guys hear, when this Broken Silence tape comes out, or if you track it down or have heard it, that guy was out there. I wondered why he was always out there sniffing and snorting. I was so naive at this time. You know, I hadn't been in Megadeth yet, so I wasn't woken up yet.
Right.
I'd just been hiding in my room playing guitar. Like, to this day, I don't drink coffee. I don't really like to drink that much, or don't take aspirin, but smoke cigarettes. But this guy was out there snorting blow, doing Keeper vocal tracks that, you know, like Journey would kill for today.
Oh my gosh.
I was like, this guy's out of hand. But he was also wild, because he would do wild stuff. Like, we'd go to Denny's and we'd be walking out, and he'd walk slow behind us. And if there was an area where they had just mopped and they hadn't put the sign down yet, he'd do a slip and fall. And he had a bunch of lawsuits where I'd go in a grocery store and he'd slip and fall in the grocery store and sue the grocery.
Oh my God.
This cat was out of control. I got to tell you, one night, this is just a great story. I don't think I've told anyone yet, but these are stories that'll be in my book.
Oh, cool.
Coming soon. We were going to the Rainbow one night, and I had by this time moved out of that band house. And long story with that. And that's what led to me getting the Megadeth gig once. Because Jay Reynolds, you said, how did I meet Jay Reynolds? He lived in this band house.
Okay.
And that might have been a long way to get to it. Pumpkin Meadows wasn't the only rocker living there, and me and my whole band sleeping upstairs on the studio floor. But Jay Reynolds was downstairs and I was giving him guitar lessons. See how everything circles around?
It does. It's great.
We were going to the Rainbow one night. The band had, you know, split apart because that manager, he became a little bit too much like a father, a little bit too much like Hitler.
Oh, gosh.
Right. And so I had to exit stage left of that band, and the whole band exited with me. Sans the drummer. So the bass player came with me and that singer came with me. And you're not going to believe who the drummer we got, but we'll get to that in a moment.
All right.
We were going, I got to tell you this Rainbow story, because who does this? Ladies and gentlemen of the jury and folks in the peanut gallery, listeners far and wide, who does this, I ask you? So one night we were going to the Rainbow and the singer was coming over to my house and he wanted a ride. Okay. So by the time he got to my house, I had just probably got done practicing or something. And I go, okay, I got to jump in the shower. So I took my jeans off, threw them over a chair, you know, put a towel on, ran in the shower and took a shower real quick. And okay. He stayed out there watching TV, listening to music, whatever. I came out and like, so suddenly his whole tone had changed. He's like, okay, well, I called a cab because there's a girl I just talked to. I'm going to meet her there. And why don't you just meet me there? I'll meet you at the Rainbow.
Hmm.
I'm like, I'm like, okay, if you want to pay for it. I said, I'm only going to be a few minutes. We can leave. But so the cab split. When I went to put my jeans on, and I had had probably a couple $100 in there.
Yeah. Uh-oh. You said had.
The interviewer, you don't even have to finish the story. The interviewer. Everyone in the audience knows what happened. Yeah.
Yeah.
He stole all my money, man.
Wow.
I was like, I couldn't even believe it. And so that was the end of him being my singer. And dude had pipes.
Gosh.
So that was a drag. And I went to the Rainbow and found him and pushed him up against the wall. And he had spent a little of the money on blow already. That's how he rolled. But he did give me back over $100. And
man,
I didn't pummel him right there in the Rainbow and just cut my losses. And
yeah,
now we're back to a band with no singer.
Right.
So it's just a bass player and a drummer. And are you ready for who the drummer is?
I'm ready.
Chris Poland's brother, Mark Poland.
Oh my God. Oh, wow. Oh man.
And he never mentioned Chris the entire time we played together. We never talked about Megadeth. Jay had walked through the house with David Elson briefly one time in the band house when I was living there in West Hollywood. So I met David Elson in passing.
Okay.
And he and Jay were friends, but you know, we had all lost touch, and it's just, again, one of those strange, small, just such a, it's a small world after all.
Yeah. He just kind of blew me away with Mark Poland. So
Mark never mentioned Chris, and I'd lost touch with everyone in that band house. And the only Megadeth experience that I had, I'd never heard of them. Jay did come to me in his room one day before or after a guitar lesson I gave him. He had a cassette of Peace Sells. I don't know if it was finished or still in the demo stages.
Yeah.
I remember Chris's solos blowing me away. I'm like, that dude sounds like Alan Holdsworth, like meets Jeff Beck. He's a killer. He goes, they might be firing this guitar player. Do you want this gig? And I was, again, like into like more the Gary Moore, Alan Holdsworth, Steve Moore's family.
Right.
I never heard anything quite like that. And so at that time I passed on it, and this is flash forward months and months later. Now I'm playing with Mark Poland in this band, and we're still doing, one of the songs was so Gary Moore, Corridors of Power. I remember to this day. And we were demoing this stuff up on a 4-track. And one day I decided I was going to call Barry and bury the hatchet, so to speak.
Right.
We hadn't spoken in a few months.
Okay.
And by this time, that band house where we all lived with Jay and Punky and the whole gang had disintegrated, and so many funny stories that'll be in the book about that house, including, I mean, it had bars on all the windows because it was a recording studio, but the police thought all these long hairs coming out was a crack house, drug dealing, coke dealing, and they busted the house one night. I was at Ralph's. Probably the same store that Big Lebowski's in at the intro. But it was a night very similar to that. And I came home and Barry was in jail and the whole house had been raided. And
oh,
it was a whole scene.
God. Oh, jeez.
Yeah, but I had lost touch with all these guys. But, you know, we'd been through so much. And one day, I was proud of the new demo tracks that I had because Mark Poland's a great drummer. Ended up hearing on some Chris Poland solo albums.
Yeah, and Damn the Machine.
Return to Metropolis. When I heard that, I was like, shit, man, that dude's way better than I even thought.
That's a great album. And the Damn the Machine stuff is awesome.
Yeah, so I had this, you know, 4-track cassette demo. Well, we're going to have to pause till this. Hold on. Every time I do an interview. The other day, that interview that you saw.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. We redid it. The phone rang so many times.
Oh my God.
We did it on another day because there were some technical difficulties in the guy's video as well. But I digress. So I decided one day on a trip into Hollywood, I was living in the valley, that I was going to stop by and see Barry. I called him and he's like, yeah, he wanted to see me. So I went over and I played in my new demo with Mark Poland on drums and the bass player that he knew and some of the guys he knew.
Mm-hmm.
And he played me my old Broken Silence songs that I had written with a new guitar player. Who happened to be the son of the guy who played the sidekick of Tarzan in the old black and white television Tarzan TV series, Sabu.
Oh,
and that's the name he went by. And it was surreal hearing the songs with another guitar player who played totally different.
Oh, I can only imagine.
Yeah. And it was just going to be kind of like a kiss and makeup afternoon. And I was actually getting ready to leave. I played my stuff. I showed him mine. He showed me his.
Mm-hmm.
I was getting ready to leave and the phone rang. And Barry answered it. And he goes, yeah. And his face kind of went white. And he goes, this is so strange because I... And he's talking to whoever's on the phone. I haven't seen him in months. And he's sitting right here at my dining room table.
Oh, my God.
Right now. Here, you can talk to him. And he passed me the phone, and it was Jay Reynolds.
Wow.
So, you know, I got on the phone. I go, hello. He goes, hey, Jeff, it's Jay. And he was being all cryptic. He's like, hey, I got a big business opportunity to talk to you about. Can you stop by my house? I'm living in Laurel Canyon now. Da-da-da-da-da. So I said, sure. You know, I had to pass by Laurel Canyon anyway to get back to the valley. That was an easy way to get home. So I stopped by, and he told me he was living in a little guest room in this really cool house that I pass every time I go through Laurel Canyon. So the memory is, it's there like it was yesterday. He said he got the gig in Megadeth, right? He was the new guitar player. And I flashed back to the hearing that cassette in his bedroom, and I was like, playing those leads that sound like Alan Holdsworth.
Yeah.
And I'd given him guitar lessons, and he was like, he was kind of like the KK Downing of the band. He was in Malice.
Okay.
Like a Judas Priest knockoff. They were on Atlantic Records, which, and that is a Zeppelin's label. And they did a couple albums.
Yeah.
He actually stole a couple of my riffs are on their album License to Kill.
Oh, geez.
A couple of my rhythms. One of them is from that Queensryche sounding song I told you about that sounded like Take Hold of the Flame that I was working on with that drummer from Artie Butler's son.
Right. Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. So he's like, I'll pay you $50 an hour to help me figure out Chris Poland's guitar solos. And I got to write solos. They only got like 2-3 weeks to finish the new album, and their tour dates in California and UK. They were playing a big thing called Christmas on Earth with Testament, Overkill, and some other band. I forget who it was.
Wow.
But so that was going to be like my first gig, I think, was this series of 4 or 6 dates up the California coast and that Christmas on Earth. But it wasn't going to be mine yet. It was going to be Jay's.
Right, right. Yeah, yeah.
So he's employing me to teach him guitar lessons, and I'd given him lessons for free. So now he's at least paying me.
Yeah.
that's how it happened. I ended up going down to the recording studio on Melrose called the Music Grinder that's no longer there. But I knew Alan Holdsworth had recorded Road Games. That's the album that when Eddie Van Halen got him a deal with Warner Brothers, his one big, big major label deal, and Eddie helped him on that album a lot. I knew he'd recorded that at Music Grinder, and one day I'm down there warming up, looking out the, you know, they had a window where you could sit looking right out on Melrose, kind of like a bar, you know, like bar stools.
Okay.
Looking out, and I had my notes there, and I was warming up, and it was you could look out one way, but people couldn't look in.
Right, yeah.
One day I'm just warming up, my eyes closed, and all of a sudden a soft knock, and I open my eyes up, and it's Belinda Carlisle from the Go-Go's pushing her nose up. Let me in, let me in. Because they'd done one of their albums there.
Oh, my God.
So suddenly, I'm teaching Jay down at the studio, and the producer was there, Paul Lanny, and they had a second engineer, a young kid. He looked like he was 17 years old, Matt Freeman.
Okay.
And David Ellison would come through, and Chuck Buehler was there a lot because he had just, I think, finished drum tracks. So lessons commenced with Jay and Ernest at Music Grinder Studios on Melrose. And we were off in a little room with a music stand. And I remember I'll rewind just to hear the day he offered me the teaching job. I drove over the hill and stopped at a 7-Eleven when there was payphones.
Yeah.
Our kids look that up. It's called a payphone. It was far preceded cell phones. Called my parents, collect, back in Ohio. Mom, Dad. I just got this job teaching guitar lessons to a buddy of mine who just got this really big gig with a band who signed to the same record label as the Beatles. You remember the first album? First couple minutes of our conversation today, that was my first album my parents bought me, was the Beatles 65.
Yeah.
Capitol Records, you know, the round building in Hollywood. Mom, Dad. And I said, this guy, he sounds like he's been playing guitar for maybe a year or two. He's like an okay rhythm guitar player. But the guy he's replacing plays like Alan Holdsworth, and my parents knew who that was.
Okay.
Because I had taken them to see him. Oddly enough, Holdsworth played My Town the night before I moved to go to GIT.
Oh, wow.
The big jazz club, he played Our Town, and I took my parents to see him that night and hopefully give them a little faith that I wasn't going out there to be some kind of a rock and roll derelict.
Right.
Be more of a session guy like Alan Holdsworth, or more of a high caliber guitar player like a Steve Lukather, Alan Holdsworth, Steve Morse. Don't worry, Mom. I'm moving to Hollywood, but, you know,
yeah,
I'll be okay.
Yeah.
So I'm telling my parents on the phone, there's no way this guy's going to do this gig replacing a guy who plays like Alan Holdsworth. He's not going to do this gig in 2-3 weeks, not in 2-3 months, not in 2-3 years, not in this lifetime.
Oh,
I can steal this gig. I can get this gig. And they said, Jeff, no. Both parents, you know, on landlines.
Right.
You know, dad on one connect, one in one room, mom in the other.
Yeah.
Advising me, just go in there, son. I can hear my dad now, and just teach this young man the best of your ability and let them see what you do. Yeah. And if they're smart enough and this guy's not that good, they're going to figure it out for themselves and they're going to hire you. And so that's what happened. And it was really, I think, Chuck and David Elfson and the producer and second engineer. I didn't really meet Dave Mustaine until this stuff was done. I met him momentarily.
Okay.
For some moments, but he wasn't in the studio during recording sessions.
Oh, okay. So you didn't have a whole lot of time then to prepare. So now I'm under the impression that some of the solos and stuff the songs weren't completed and you had to go in and kind of...
Yeah, well, that's the challenge. Therein lies the challenge. And I'm, you know, the previous guitarist, Chris Poland and Marty, they had a lot more time to rehearse with the band and there was pre-production and all that. And people love that album, but hopefully they'll take it into consideration. And, you know, I think it's a feather in my cap that I didn't get to rehearse with the band. I never heard any song in its entirety.
God.
I had literally the brief conversation I had with Dave was when they invited me to come down after some people had reported back to him and they said, this guy's the guy, you know?
Yeah.
I had a message on my answer machine. I came home from a rodeo one night and to be honest, I was about 2-3 months from leaving California and moving to Austin or New York or London or somewhere.
Oh, wow.
So I was done. I thought it was a lot of posers out here.
Yeah.
But there was my answer machine was beeping. It was Dave Mustaine and he wanted to see me at the studio. And by this time I had been teaching Jay a couple, 2-3 days. The first thing I started trying to teach him and I started writing was the solo to Hook and Mouth. Cause it is in a way repetitive, but it's way harder than I meant it to be. When I started writing it, like it's kind of Michael Schenker-y, kind of Flight of the Bumblebee.
Yeah.
It sounds like a Russian jig or something. It was way, way harder than he could do. I mean, it's hard for me to do. I still use that to keep my chops up as a great exercise, and my students love to learn that one. But
oh, yeah.
I was writing a couple solos and trying to teach them to me, and he was struggling. So that's what I think led to that answering machine message. And I went down and we walked up and down Melrose, and he gave me a cassette tape of In My Darkest Hour at the end once we got back to the music grinder. It had like 60 seconds of In My Darkest Hour, and he pushed play and he goes, it was like maybe a 20-second roll up with no vocals. It's the part where, you know, that he's going, you just laugh, ha ha, bitch.
Yes.
You know, that whole, that wasn't there yet. It was the music and the drums, bass, and rhythm guitar. And he goes, okay, start here. And I hear the, where I'm going to be selling. He goes, stop there and come back tomorrow. And so I went home that night, and this is where what I said at the very beginning, where preparation and hard work and luck intersect, because luckily I was preparing hard at that time for, I didn't even know what, I mean, I was demoing stuff with Mark Poland, and that by this time had kind of fallen apart.
Okay.
Because the singer was, you know, off snort and blow, the one.
You're right.
You know, probably the lines, he graduated up to 6-foot lines that were inch wide by this time.
2 yards.
And he did the shit bag, did go and make some kind of a record deal with some company, and some fan sent it to me and put out those Broken Silence tracks, 4 of them. My songs that I wrote and co-wrote, and so.
That's awful.
Yeah. So, luckily, I remember the big album for me right then was Gary Moore, Victims of the Future, because his tone on that record and his solos were just blistering. And his tone and solos had always been blistering. So I was figuring that stuff out and really practicing a lot. And by this time, by the end of GIT, my chops were up. It was by the end of the year, I'd been working in that studio, playing with some musicians, and I mean, for sure, the best they'd been in my young years, so I was ready for something. And when the call came, you know, and he gave me that tape, I went home that night and put the tape in. Again, kids were still working with cassette tapes. And, you know, it was however long that solo is, I just played some, you know, it's like we call playing over the changes. I just like came up with some, it's like if an artist, when he starts pencil sketching before he starts painting with colors,
right,
just sketching it out.
Okay.
So, and he may sketch out a couple different pages and a couple different alternatives before he lands on what it's going to be. And that's kind of how I look at, you know, writing solos. So I did that as fast as possible. And, you know, like, you know, again, into the frying pan.
Right. Yeah.
Because I'm going back tomorrow. I mean, it was already the evening when I got home. It was already like 6, 7 at night, and I had just a little time. And I came up with basically what you hear. And I went in the next day, and I remember I was really shy and turned my back to the mixing board, and my nose was almost pressed to the back wall of the studio.
Oh, my gosh.
Back with everybody, and I just... I did a couple takes of that solo. I mean, you could say it was a loose improvisation because I had sketched out some ideas, but when you're in the studio, some of the things, I mean, I just, you know, I played a few things and I really quickly, this is what I need to do. And what you hear is what you got.
Wow.